Yes. Thank you, Pastor Jeremy. Thank you, worship team. Not by power, not by might. Has anyone been facing some God problems recently? Goodness. I'll tell you what, yesterday I was on the way home from a work event outside of the church, obviously, because I don't really face those kind of problems here in the church. Amen. It's the flesh and blood that we face. And my response was very negative. I was very upset. My wife calls me. She's like, honey, what's wrong? You should be excited. You get to come home. I said, I'm not excited. I'm not happy. And I am ready to come home. She goes, you know, you should probably pray. And I said, I know what I should do. I don't want to. And as I said that, I realized how ridiculous that sounds. That we know as Christ followers what we should do. How often is that the last thing we want to do? The things we know we should do, we don't. And sometimes we have God problems that we try to fix ourselves. And they weren't meant for us to fix. Amen? Hey, well, listen up. My name is Murphy. Welcome to the journey. This is home. So good to see everybody. Y'all got really loud during worship. And then you got really quiet when I got up here. So let's cut that out. I need you to shout back at me. That's the only way we're going to get through this together. Amen? Hey, there we go. Thank you very much. Listen, my name is Murphy. I'm the student pastor here at the Journey Church. And Pastor Darrell gracefully gave me the opportunity to open our new series today called At the Movies. Everybody say At the Movies. There we go. We can get you talking today. So I love the movies. Ever since I was a little kid, my sister called me something like a TV head. Anyone else get called a TV head? No, just me? Okay, I'm going to have a word with her later. So I love the movies. I was a huge movie buff. Anyone else a movie buff in here? You just love going to the movies. I love popcorn. I love everything about it, right? And so I'm going to use a movie today to help me convey the message I believe God's given me today. And it's a movie that I really connected with as a kid. You know, as a young athlete, I aspired to be like this. Maybe it's because I was 100 and nothing, 5 foot nothing, and I had zero athletic ability. And if you get that quote, you know that we are going to be covering the movie Rudy today. American football classic. It's going to be fantastic. Someone said, what? Okay, so what I want you to do before I give you any more details, I want you to check out this scene.
Listen up. For you seniors, this is your last practice. And with the exception of Thomas, Lee, Bo, Sipich, you get on the weights. Tomorrow night will be the last time the rest of you ever put on a football uniform. You know, these last 4 years have gone by too fast. They always do. All right, seniors, stay here. Underclassmen, two lines, 5 yards apart. Let's go. Hey, Rudy, we're going to miss you.
You're next, Dunnington. Come on, Pete. Lee.
I can't believe it's over.
All right, I just want to point out, he barely hit his coach. So I don't know what he thought he was thinking he's a football player. That looked like me hitting somebody in a bag. So Rudy Rudiger, he grew up in a place called Joliet, Illinois. It's a true story, based off a true story. Brandon refused to believe this is a true story. I don't know why. So he grew up as a second-generation immigrant from Germany, right? And so his family, they moved to the States. They're just living the American dream. They're just happy to be there. And in that region in the United States, they're really big football fans. And they particularly, they loved the Notre Dame Fighting Irish. I mean, they were big fans. They watched it. Like, his dad says in one of the scenes, there ain't nothing going on this TV except Notre Dame football. And you know what? I felt that. So Rudy, as you see, he had a dream, right? So Rudy's dream was he was going to play football for the Fighting Irish. It's a bit far-fetched, but we'll go with it. Okay. And now here's the problem. Rudy's senior year, it's his last practice for his last game, and he's really struggling. He realizes that all likelihood his football career is over. He's done. And I think he struggled with that because the football field's where he found purpose. It's where he found his value. It's where he felt he had meaning. But you want to know the truth? I think that Rudy, more than anything, he wasn't called to be a football player, but he was called to be a leader. But the football field was an avenue for him to walk through that leadership. And so the point one, I'm going to have 4 points for you today, and these are points and lessons that we can take away from Rudy's life. Okay, so if you're going to be taking notes, I want you to write this down. Point one, aim to be what you are called to be. See, church, you shouldn't aim to be anything you want to be. You should aim to be what you are called to be. See, we all have a calling on our lives. Whether you're a Christ follower or not, it doesn't change the calling on your life. And see, while you may be, you know, it may look different for you than it is for me, and, you know, you could be, the calling could be to be a police officer or a firefighter or a teacher or in the military, you know, whatever it is, it may not even be vocational ministry. The calling on your life is the same, as just as the sacrifice is the same. So in Mark 1, Jesus, sometime after he was baptized and he was tested in the wilderness, he set off to begin calling on his disciples, right? So the first he set upon were Andrew and Simon. And so we find that in Mark 1, 17 through 18. If you have your Bibles, I want you to go there with me. And so as Jesus walked along the Sea of Galilee, in verse 17 it says, "Come follow me," Jesus said, "and I will send you out to fish for people." And at once... don't miss that. They said, at once, they left their nets and they followed him. So something I don't want us to miss, church, following Jesus requires us to leave something behind. You hear that? So following Jesus is nice until, wait a second, I have to leave something behind. See, both Andrew and Simon, they had something in their hands. They had something that represented, well, one, their livelihood. It represented their purpose, their income. And much like Rudy, it gave them purpose. But they couldn't follow Jesus without first dropping what they had in their hands. So Rudy, not understanding his true calling, fast forward 4 years, he found himself still in that same small town, surrounded by the same people, working in a steel mill with his family. And so Rudy, he's missing his calling. The calling on his life didn't change, but he's not walking in it. And so he found himself where he was. And so this is a very defining moment in Rudy's life. So he's at work one day. His best friend, Pete, that you saw in the video, they're at work, and a tragic accident happens, and Pete dies. It's really sad. And so Rudy, at his funeral, he decides, you know what? I don't know what I'm supposed to do, but I know I can't stay here anymore. And so what does he do? He goes to the only place he knows. He goes to South Bend, Indiana, where he goes to the University of Notre Dame. And so that leads us to our second point, point two. Know where to go when you face adversity. So when you face adversity, you have to know where to go, but you have to have the correct response. Anyone here ever faced adversity? Maybe recently, maybe currently? See, Rudy didn't know exactly what to do, but he did know where to go. And so my question is, where do you go when you face adversity? Do you look inward? Like, I can fix this. I can take care of it. If I just work hard enough, I try hard enough. Or do you look upward? Is the problem God's? So are you the type of person that answers inward or upward? And if I'm being honest, the inward response is not an uncommon response. But there are some problems, and just like the song we sang before I came out here, there are some problems that only God can solve. And so Psalms 34, verse 4 says, "I sought the Lord, and he answered me. He delivered me from all of my fears." And you know what, church, sometimes God doesn't remove the problem in our lives like we pray for. I say, "God, you know what, it'd be really great if you just removed this problem." You know what he does sometimes? Sometimes what he does is he allows you the ability to work through the problem. We want it to go away, but God's like, "No, I want to teach you something." And so, moving forward in this story, Rudy makes it to South Bend, right? And I just love that the only person available for him, because he gets there like 5 a.m., is a priest. And it's Father Cavanaugh. So Father Cavanaugh helps Rudy get enrolled into Holy Cross, which is a junior college. And that was a huge deal. But there's a theme in this story, and that is adversity. And so Rudy's hit with adversity again and again when he keeps applying to get into Notre Dame semester after semester, and he does never get in. 2 years pass, he never gets into Notre Dame. So I want you to check out this scene.
Maybe I haven't prayed enough.
I'm sure that's not the problem.
Praying is something we do in our time. The answers come in God's time.
Have I done everything I possibly can? Can you help me?
Son, in 35 years of religious studies, I've come up with only two hard, incontrovertible facts. There is a God, and I'm not him.
Man, I love what Father Kavanaugh said right there. He said, prayer is something we do in our time. The answer comes in God's time. How many times we experience that, right? So how true is that, though? How great of a reminder to us that we have absolutely zero perception of God's timing. See, we think that when we pray and we do everything we should, and 2 + 2 = 4, and therefore God should answer our prayer, right? I mean, I did everything you wanted me to, God. What did I do wrong? You see, I believe that what Rudy was going through so far was to prepare him for what God was taking him to. How many times in our life we curse the things that God is taking us through as if it is the problem, but the problem is our response. Maybe what God's trying to do is show us something. Maybe he's trying to teach you. Maybe he's trying to prepare you. So can I tell you something? And this is by no means to degrade the job I just came from, but for 3 years, I was the kids pastor here at this church, and I loved it, okay? I loved it. Pastor Tommy, don't laugh. I loved it, okay? And there were some difficult seasons, okay? And there were times where I thought, God, why do you have me here? What are you trying to teach me? Can I just be done? Can I be done? But God said, no, you haven't learned what I need you to learn yet. And it wasn't until I became content in my circumstances where God then opened the next door. Sometimes we need to answer with contentment before God's going to open the next door. So, how many of us can relate to Rudy's situation? You see, what we do is we like to question the manner for which God does things. And see, our translation of Romans 8:28 is, well, if it's good in our eyes, then it's good. But Romans 8:28 says, we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good. But we like to try to, you know, navigate that and tweak it a little bit to make sure it fits our agenda. How many times in your life you experience the fact that your agenda and God's agenda rarely line up, right? So Isaiah 55, 8-9 says, for my thoughts are not your thoughts. Are you sure, God? Neither are my ways your ways, declares the Lord. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways and my thoughts than your thoughts. See, church, the sooner we understand that God's timing and our timing rarely align, and it's not because of God, the better off we will be. Amen? So moving along, Rudy does finally make it into Notre Dame. He begins the walk-on process. So here's another spoiler alert. He makes the team, and he's defying all odds. And it's really beautiful, too, because, you know, he faces a ton of adversity. And Rudy finally, but what he's doing, he's surrounding himself with the right people, right? And so people on the football team, the coaches, people in his school, because he wasn't a great student either. But he makes it on the football team. He works so hard. He probably works harder than everybody on the team. And so at the end of his junior year, the coach pulls Rudy into the office. He says, Rudy, I got to tell you, you've earned it. So next year, your senior year, we are going to let you dress. All right? You're going to dress for one game. And this is a big deal because in this time, at this particular program, walk-ons did not dress. You watch the game in the bleachers. But you're part of the team. You get beat up, but, you know, you ain't really on the team. And so to dress to meant you were actually a part of this team. And so the coach's like, I'm going to reward your hard work. And Rudy's all excited. He's calling mom. He's like, Mom, Dad, you better make sure you get up here. I'm going to be playing next year. They're like, when? He's like, I don't know. But just come anyways. Every week, I'm going to be there. And so Rudy's all excited, and everything's going great. And if you know this movie and you've so far caught on to the theme of this movie, it's adversity. So right after that happens, Coach Parsegian, he retires. Rudy's like, are you kidding me? He doesn't care that the coach retired. He cares that he's not going to be able to play anymore. And so in comes Coach Devine. He's former coach of the Green Bay Packers. He's a hard-nosed coach. He doesn't give a crap about walk-ons. He thinks Rudy should not be like carrying the water jugs, not playing. And so Rudy is so distraught, right? Rudy's like, I'm going to quit. I'm done. But remember the people that he had in his life. So how many times have you been somewhere in your life where you wanted to quit? And if not for the people around you, you would have. So Rudy surrounded himself with people who were going to lift his arms up, that cared about his soul rather than his feelings. See, because Rudy was in his feelings, and it was real. He was upset. He had been hurt. And they said, I don't care about your feelings. The truth is, you need to go back, because that is where you're supposed to be. And so Rudy goes back for his final week of practice, knowing he's not going to dress for the final game. But what he didn't know is that the story wasn't over. Y'all check out this last scene.
Yeah.
Oh, hi, Roland. Come in.
I want Rudy to dress in my place, Coach. He deserves it.
Don't be ridiculous. Georgia Tech is one of the top offensive teams in the country. You're an All-American and our captain. Act like it.
I believe I am.
Me too, Coach. I want Rudy to dress in my place. Coach, this is Rudy. For Rudy, Coach.
All right, y'all, don't start crying now. We ain't done yet. Proverbs 17:17 says, a friend loves at all times, and a brother is born for a time of adversity. You see, I can recognize that Rudy didn't have all the answers. He didn't have all the wisdom or the skills, the knowledge or the athleticism, but he surrounded himself with people who did. You see, when the hard times came, he had the support of those who cared about his soul. So here we are, we're at the final game. Rudy is dressed. He runs out of the tunnel. The fans are going nuts. His family's up there. D-Bop's up there. Jon Favreau, savior of the Star Wars universe. Right? Only Star Wars fans got that. That's okay. And so everyone's there. They're cheering him on. And you know what happens? This is what happens. You ready? The coach looks down the line. They're winning. They're killing Georgia Tech. Sorry, Chad. They're killing Georgia Tech. And he looks down the line. He goes, hey, Rudy, I love you. You work so hard. Get out there. No, that's not what happened at all. Actually, this is what happened. So he goes, hey, you know what? Put all the seniors in. He said, Coach, what about Rudy? No. He's a senior, Coach. I don't care. Well, Coach, he should play. No. And so, obviously, that was not going the way that we wanted it to, but it wasn't over there. Then you started hearing it. Do y'all know what we heard? Rudy, 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 Rudy.
Thank you.
cut an onion, my boy. Oof. Oh, my goodness. Oh, I can do this. Okay. So if you notice something about this awesome scene, like Rudy is at the pinnacle of everything he was hoping to achieve, right? And rarely was the camera on him. We consistently saw the people that Rudy had affected while he was there. You saw his family. You saw his friends. You saw the people who poured into him, who encouraged him. And so can I tell you something, church? Our final point today, point four, your obedience is not about you. I'll say it one more time. Your obedience is not about you. The fruit of your obedience is going to affect everyone you come into contact. See, we can never underestimate the power of your testimony to those that you come into contact with. See, there could be people, and there probably is, people in your life who are hanging on by a thread of hope. And they hang on because of the faith that you show. So I want to tell you this story, and I'm going to begin closing. So the band's going to come out. They're going to lead us in another song before we head out of here today. But I wanted to tell you this story. Earlier this year, I was in St. Augustine. I was celebrating one of my best friend's birthdays. And we were walking down the street, and someone grabbed me on my shoulder. First of all, when you're in a town that's not your hometown, someone grabs you. It's like that fight or flight thing. So this kid almost died. Dominique would have got him. But I didn't kill him. I went, ah! I turned around, and he goes, Mr. Murphy, is that you? And I want to also point out, I didn't like being called Mr. Murphy. That made me feel a little older than I wanted to. I'm moving on. I know. I'm going to move on. And so, he's Mr. Murphy, is that you? I said, yeah. And he held onto my shoulders, and he looked me in my eyes, and something strange happened. He started to cry, and I'm like, you okay? And he said, you don't understand. I would have been dead if not for you. And so to give you a little bit of context to this, he was a student that played basketball at Yulee, and I mentored him when I was a chaplain on their basketball team. And that was also during a season of my life where I didn't want to do what God was calling me to do. I didn't want to. I wanted to quit. And he looked at me and he said, I would be dead if not for you. What does that say about just obedience? What if I had quit? I would like to believe that God would have brought someone else into his life to do what I failed at. And maybe God would have. I don't know. But I can know this for certain. If I had, I would have never been able to experience what it is like to be used by God in changing someone's eternity. And so I say that, church, to encourage you in something. If God's calling you to do something, you can't stop. James 1, 2 through 4 says, consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance. Let perseverance finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything. You see, Rudy found himself 4 years removed from high school. Still where he was, still running from where he was called. And I can't help but feel like maybe there's someone in the room, you find yourself in a steel mill. Maybe you're running from where God's calling you because it's comfortable. Maybe it's more comfortable than what God's calling you to do. And I got to tell you, we have to get to a place, church, where we desire what God wants for us more than we desire to be comfortable. And the sooner or later, we have to decide to pick up the things in our life and head off to where he's calling us. But in doing so, we have to lay down the things that we have in our hands so that we can pick up what God has for us. So as I close, can I have everyone stand up in the room? The worship team's going to come out. They're going to lead us in this song. And I don't know where you find yourself. I don't know if maybe God has been calling you for years and you've been ignoring him for years. But can I encourage you to do something? Just say yes. Be obedient, even if you don't know what's going to happen. Because the obedience is not about you. The obedience is for those that people that are around you that God's going to use you to reach. So if everyone could just bow their heads, close their eyes, just so we don't have any distractions. I want to pray for you today. And as the worship team leads us in this prayer, I know that following God, it can be challenging. Stepping out into a place of discomfort can be challenging, but it's necessary. So God, right now I pray for every single person in this room, God. If there is someone here that does not know you, God, you have been calling after them. They have been ignoring you, God. I pray that today they would say yes. God, today their answer is yes, God. And for the Christ follower in the room, God, I pray that they would recognize where you are calling them. God, that fear has no place in their life. God, doubt has no place in their life. And that their answer today, God, would be, wherever you send me, I will go. We give you the glory for that. In Jesus' name, amen.